Sorry about this. Good afternoon and welcome to this first event on for the Climate Smart Chefs. Welcome you to it. It's a very exciting event that we are holding today. It's an introduction to the roadmap to our Vision 2030 for the Climate Smart Chefs. And my name is Duncan Williamson. I'm your host today. I've been working on sort of sustainable diet since 2008. And when I first started working on this subject area, there were really only three organizations that were sort of seeing this as a priority for action, which was the Barilla Foundation, WWF, and the UN. Since then, this has exploded in importance with more and more people working on it. And it's great to see how it's risen up the agenda as we're looking at food systems, and how food systems now includes discussions around production, consumption and waste, as well as environmental technology. And in that time, I must say that Climate Smart Chefs, I'm very proud to be involved with it, because I find it one of the most exciting and inclusive events that I have sort of been involved in. It's very welcoming. It's really active about having as many participants as we can involved in this project in creating a roadmap and a vision for 2030. I'm sorry about this, I'm not able to share my screen. So during this program, just so you know, your microphone and video are not going to be active during the roundtable, but chat will be enabled and we'll be harvesting questions that you come up with. And please use the chat to introduce yourselves to other participants and to ask questions. If you cannot hear us speaking, please check that your computer speakers and headset are not muted. You can click auto settings to see which speaker's headset you have active on Zoom. And if you have any technical difficulties during the roundtable, please just click leave and join the roundtable again through the link you have via the email. And finally, the roundtable will be recorded and made available online on the project website. But we have a really exciting agenda for you today. This session will last for 1 hour, and in the agenda you will find that we'll have an introduction to the Climate Smart Chefs project by Marta Antonelli. She's a project coordinator and head of research at the Barilla Foundation. And then we're going to have two really important and really interesting talks around climate change, food and consumer behavior, so we can all understand the problem and be on the same page. One from Riccardo Valentini, the full professor of forest ecology at Tusker University, and the second from Sophie Hake, the research advisor at the European Food Information Council. Once we've had this introduction, we will then go on to the roadmap to the Climate Smart Vision 2030. And this, as well as having an introduction to the process and what we're doing, we'll have three pitches from the thematic sessions on healthy, sustainable diets, food waste and technology. And finally, this will lead into a roundtable discussion where we will ask a group of expert panelists, Will Nicholson, Paul Newham, Radio, and Susan Neal, we'll have a chance to ask some questions that you've come up with, and to have their thoughts on this programme. So without further ado, I would like to hand over to Marta Antonelli to present the project to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Duncan, for the introduction. And I would like to thank everyone for joining us today. This is the beginning of an exciting roadmap that will lead us to develop what we call a 2030 vision for a climate smart chef to help the European Union to implement the objectives of the Farm to Fork strategy and also the targets that we have in terms of climate change mitigation. So I'm very glad to present to go through the objectives and the key activities of the Climate Smart Chefs project. Let me thank, just to start, the project partners. So the project is coordinated by the Barilla Foundation, but we have another four amazing partners that work with us and will work on this over the next 3 years, 2 years and a half almost. So it's ALMA, ENAIPNET, YAMCO University of Applied Sciences and Nutritics. So three countries involved, Italy, Finland and Ireland as countries where the different institutions and companies are located, but we have an ambition. And the ambition is to develop a training and education program for chefs and cooks to become climate smart and be game changers and also ambassadors of a more sustainable and healthier and also affordable diet in Europe. So how we are doing this? First of all, we want to involve them. So if you are a chef or if you belong to a chef association, please get in touch with us because we have plenty of opportunities of engagement and to build a network of like-minded chefs, cooks, and associations that really want to accelerate the transformation of the food system in Europe. Secondly, what we want to do is to provide chefs with the knowledge and tools to generate this change in recipe design, in menu planning, and also in communication with customers. So we want to foster awareness on climate, environmental, and nutritional issues and how to combine them for meals and better choices also for consumers. And then we want to promote a mainstream debate on food as a key factor for climate change mitigation. As you know, up to 37% of global greenhouse gas emissions are emitted from farm to fork to disposal. And so it's clear that the food sector needs to do its part, of course, in this pathway of transition. So just a quick look at the key project activities. We are going to implement a high-level training course for chefs. The first edition will be run in January. There are going to be 8 editions until the end of the project. The registration are open. So please take a look at the website and register in case you are interested. Second activity is the development of a digital tool to design climate smart menus. And this is exactly where Nutritics comes in the project. And this is a very important part of it because they say you cannot manage what you can't measure. And so this is exactly what we aim to do through this tool. Thirdly, we are going to launch an award dedicated to climate smart chefs, but also local initiatives promoting sustainable diets and healthier diets as well. So this will be launched in mid-2023. So stay tuned also for this. There is already the possibility to join the EU network of chefs association. And it's open to anyone who is interested. So again, this is a concrete possibility to engage. And last not least, the implementation of a Life Climate Smart Chef's vision for the year 2030. That is a strategic paper aimed at providing policy recommendation to support the EU climate policy and also the farm to fork strategy. And this is exactly what we are doing today right now. With you. This is the first step of this roadmap, which will lead us to develop this paper through a participative project. So with you all. Having said that, I would love to ask my colleagues to share a video that we prepared with you just to summarize the project, and then we'll go ahead with the program that we have for today. Thank you.
Food is not just food. Food is part of us, of our way of life. Food is a choice, the most important choice for saving the planet. If much of total GHG emissions are due to the food system, actions for a green revolution also take place in the kitchen. And all chefs are called to play a central role in this revolution. The Life Climate Smart Chefs project aims to empower chefs to create a climate smart, sustainable and healthy food system in the European Union. It provides chefs with the knowledge and tools to reduce the environmental impact of food. How? With the implementation of a high-level training course for chefs, the development of a digital tool to design climate-smart menus, the creation of an award dedicated to climate-smart chefs, the creation of an EU network of chef associations. The Life Climate Smart Chefs project actively involves European chefs as game changers. Food is a key factor in mitigating climate change. It's easy to join us. We're already on the same team. Empowering chefs to promote healthy and sustainable food. Taking care of food means taking care of the planet.
Thank you. Very good to see that. And that's, I mean, that is why I'm so excited to be part of this project. I do think it is one of the most exciting, empowering projects that I've seen in my years of working in food systems. But I'd like to invite now to talk around why it is so important, our two experts. So I'll invite Ricardo to start outlining some of the problems that we have. Thank you, Ricardo.
Thank you, Daikan, and I hope I can share my screen now. Just one second. Okay. I think it's okay. You can see it. Okay. Thank you for this opportunity. And I'm really also very excited to be part of this project and to really work with you guys. I think it's very important to mention the role of the food system in the global greenhouse gas emissions. And we do know today that it's not, the climate change is not only a problem of energy, but it's also a problem of the food, of the agri-food system. In total, 37% almost of greenhouse gas emissions are involved by the food system from the farm to fork. Just to give you an idea, the electricity contribution to climate change is about 14, 15 billions of tons of CO2 equivalent, and the food system is in between 14 and 18. So we have the same size of the electricity sector in generating greenhouse gas emissions. It's important to mention EU in this because the Green Deal and the climate policy of EU is heading to net zero emission 2050 and reducing 90% of emission reductions by 2050 again. So the difference between 90% and zero should be captured by carbon storage. But the food system can play a role here to help in this pathway to reduce emissions and to help to reduce the 90% of emissions. It's a really very challenging target for EU. We do know more things today, particularly we know the impact of food on greenhouse gas emissions, and this is just a database recently published in another project, the LIFE project again, Suitable Life, where we have now a very large database of food and their carbon footprint, the water footprint, so we can estimate their impact, as well as today we know, for example, what could be the ideal diet for saving the planet, let's say, for reducing greenhouse gas emissions. For example, we estimated that something like 2.3 kilograms CO2 equivalent is allowed per day per person to stay within the limit of the 2 degrees warming that is our target coming from the climate point. So which we all of us should eat this way with this amount of impact on CO2 emission, we could help to reach the 2 degrees warming. However, not everybody is doing that. And if you look at for example, the Mediterranean countries of EU, we know that the Mediterranean diet is very helpful and very in line with this limit of emission, but in reality, also the Mediterranean people in Europe, they eat much more. They eat 4.5 kilograms of equivalent per day instead of 2.3. So we are not able to convey this message. We are not able, even in the Mediterranean region, to have sustainable diet. And finally, I leave you with a couple of reflections. One is that we also import a lot of food in Europe. So whatever we do in Europe, it can be undermined by the fact that we import food that has a very high level of emissions. And so when we look at sustainable food in Europe, we should also look at our regional food, at our 0 kilometer, let's say, or internally produced food, because it's the only guarantee that is not impacting the climate too much. And finally, the fact that what is the real price of the food? We don't have yet an economic accountability to take into account the externality of the cost of the impact of greenhouse gas emission of the food system. And so when we look at price of the food, we should find a way to include also the extra cost due to the impact and to discount this for the farmers or for the providers that have a sustainable agenda for the food production. Thank you so much for this opportunity, and I hope we have a good discussion then.
Oh, thank you so much, Ricardo. That was really useful, a really nice whistle-top tour of some of the issues with the food system. If you could stop sharing your screen, that would be fantastic. And now, thank you very much. And now can I pass over to you, Sophie? I'm really interesting to hear your insights as well, please.
Absolutely, Duncan. Thank you so much. And you should now be seeing my slides as well. So Ricardo just basically showed us a couple of the problems that we're facing. And I would like to build on this by talking a little bit about a possible solution. And I've really been giving this a lot of thought, like, what should I talk about today? I have only 5 minutes. How can I make this worthwhile? So I did a bit of research, as a scientist, that's what you do. And I came across this concept that I would like to share with you today, not because it's novel, but because it really serves as the legitimization and the existence really for this project. The best part about it is it's already happening. It's already something that chefs are living and breathing in terms of transforming the food system into a more sustainable one. So I wanted to share with you a little bit of an impulse today. And I wanted to talk about something that is called food democracy. The idea is that it is about active participation in our choices, but engaging with the food system. And it was developed in the 90s as a response really to what was perceived as a dominance of the food industry in the food system. It was really being shaped only by the food industry, and there was a lack of participation, especially of consumers in the food system. And I've come across this study by these authors that argued, well, other than consumers, it's also chefs who can take part in shaping the food system. So this notion has developed of food citizens. And that's really anyone that engages in food-related behaviors with the idea to develop a more democratic, a social, economic, and environmentally friendly, sustainable food system. And they talked about the principles of food democracy, and they wanted to see when they interviewed chefs in their study, which has come out recently, just earlier this year. And they wanted to see if these principles are already being applied. And those principles really are 5 very fundamental and easy concepts. First and foremost, it's all about collaboration. You have to work with the other actors towards a more sustainable food system. And that means that you have to create knowledge in yourselves as chefs, but also with your clients, your customers, your guests, and of course, the farmers and producers that you work with. So you educate, you stimulate curiosity with the aim to help drive change. And all of this is not only possible if you share your ideas, if you discuss and refine them, if you take on feedback from your guests, but also from other chefs, from your farmers, your producers, along the system, along the food system, because it is a collaborative effort. And it's all to do with efficacy. So really, what works and what doesn't? What truly creates an actual impact on the food system and makes it more sustainable? And last but not least, it's this notion that it's for the community good. So valuing a public good, and sustainability very much is a public good, over individual goals. So it focuses on respect, welfare, and food security. And what I really liked was that the authors then mentioned one great example of food citizenship as the Chef's Manifesto. And you can see here, I just put this together from the website. Those are like the 8 fundamental goals that they have set themselves. They have over 1,000 chefs from around the world that have signed up and pledged to this manifesto. And they are empowering chefs to work with this framework that is very closely tied to the sustainable development goals that we are trying to achieve by 2030. And so what they've done is they've interviewed chefs and tried to figure out if they can put what chefs are already doing as food citizens and try and put this into a framework, because the goal, and I thought that was really well put, so I just put this here, is chefs can be food citizens. So they engage actively, they participate actively in shaping the food system. And they use this idea of food democracy to create more food citizens by inspiring their guests, by inspiring other chefs, and by certainly working with and inspiring the farmers and producers. So what they found was the actors that are influenced when chefs participate in food democracy are obviously the customers and guests, but also their personal networks, because you go home from a great food experience and you tell your friends, your family, you start thinking of maybe sharing those recipes yourselves. Another actor that is influenced is other chefs because of trainings that chefs give, but also because of trends that they create, develop, and foster. And last but not least, the actors that can be influenced are farmers and producers through creating new demands, but also through developing new practices, whether it's cooking or it's sourcing, it is logistics, it is obtaining the ingredients. And the actions that are taken that came out of these interviews with chefs was really 2 main goals. One is to attract and demonstrate deliciousness. In and of itself, I think you can already feel it, like the way you describe foods in your menu, the taste experience you deliver, but also the innovative meals that you put together. And the other goal is to educate and engage your audience. You can build knowledge and awareness by engaging your guests. You can introduce new foods or ingredients or even cooking techniques. And you can inspire through new recipes that people might then take home and try themselves. And the outcomes really are the drivers are to change people's values, everybody involved to change practices in cooking and sourcing, and to ultimately change our behavior towards a more sustainable food system. And so this is what I wanted to share with you just as a little impulse and maybe also a positive side note that we're already doing great things, and especially chefs are already taking this on without maybe possibly knowing sometimes that they're already being food citizens and they're taking part in food democracy. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sophie. Yes, I do like the idea of us being food citizens, not just, say, for me, just a consumer, which seems very faceless. So I find that very positive. And I'd like to say that both Sophie and Ricardo have agreed to be advisors on this project, and we're deeply honoured to have such an esteemed lineup of advisors to help us get this project working and make sure it achieves what it needs to achieve. So I will just now go on to share the next part of the project. I'd like to talk a bit about the Climate Smart Chef's roadmap to the Vision 2030. And this is really the crux of what we're doing. And it's very new, it's very innovative. We have a slide, but for some reason I can't share my screen at the moment. But I'll just talk you through it. So the roadmap is going to inform EU policy, the farm to fork policy we've got at the EU, but it'll also help chefs, food producers, and us as food citizens engage on sustainable food going forward and help us to deliver by 2030 the future we need, the future that's so important and so urgent. And as part of this roadmap, we're going to have three roundtables organized into parallel thematic sessions to discuss opportunities for chefs to be part of the wider EU strategy. The three sessions are going to be on healthy and sustainable diets, food waste, and technology tools for chefs. Healthy and sustainable diets will be led by our partner, Yank. Food waste will be led by ENAP, and technology for chefs will be led by Nutritics. And we will have these sessions over a period of several months. The first one will be on the 1st of December, the second on the 8th of February, and the third will be on the 26th of April. And these will, each session will follow on from each other, they'll build on each other. So the first session will focus on the framing, the challenges and the constraints, whether it's diets, waste or technology. The one on February the 8th will look at the needs and opportunities, building on the first one. And then the final session will be ideas for action and recommendations. And what we are planning to do is the outcome of these is they will be pulled together into a strategic paper that will gather the views of each of the sections and of the stakeholders to produce this roadmap. And they'll also inform the vision that we will produce. And we will be writing them up to create the vision for our final session, which will happen in June, where we will present the roadmap and we will present the vision before publishing it online in July. And as you can see, that is only going to be 9 months. It's a very, very short time to produce it, but we've got to move quickly. Time is running out and the urgency around this is very, very important. We think if we can get it all out there by July, we can then start building on it, putting it out to people, talking to more people and engaging on it and delivering the change that we need. So I really urge you to sign up to this. Sign up now because there's limited spaces for each of the thematic sessions. We've designed them in such a way that if you can't join all three, but you can only join one or two of them, that's fine because we will build on each one and we will give a summary of the previous session or previous sessions before each one. So you can join them and don't feel bound to all of them. Or failing that, join us at the final plenary session in June next year where we can talk about the outcomes of these sessions. But what we're going to do now is very fortunate that the leads for each of the organisations, so I have Francesca from Yank, Manuela from ENAP and Karen from Nutritics, they will give you a 3-minute pitch each around their sessions and why their session is the one that you really, really, really want to join. So I'm going to do it in the order of diets, waste and technology and tools for chefs. So without further ado, I'd like to invite Francesca from Yank to give us her 3 minutes on why sustainable diets is the one that we all want to join. So can I hand the screen over to Francesca, please?
Yes, thanks a lot, Duncan, for the introduction. As we know, the food choices that we make every day have huge impact on the environment, with up to 37% of greenhouse gas emissions linked to the food system. Also, the use of fresh water is heavily affected by food production, as it uses 70% of the fresh water available on Earth. In terms of land use, in the past 20 years, almost 90% of deforestation has occurred in relation to the expansion of areas dedicated to cropland, animal feed production, or to grazing for livestock. This goes hand in hand with a general increase of meat consumption worldwide, which has increased of almost 2 kilograms per capita in the past 10 years. Things are not well in the oceans either, with huge shares of fish stocks being already overfished or being at their maximum yield. This data supports the evidence for how crucial it is that we take action towards making changes in the way we produce and consume food. Not only this will reduce the current pressure on environmental resources, but it will also improve the health issues related to food consumption. This is because each year, about 41 million deaths globally can be linked to malnutrition and poor quality diets. And it is also important to keep in mind the so-called double burden of malnutrition, where significant amounts of people are going hungry while as many struggle with issues related to obesity or overweight. Many studies have highlighted this strong link between the environmental sustainability and the healthiness of diets, but more needs to be done in order to translate this into practice and to enable improvements around us. In the session dedicated to healthy and sustainable diets, we will focus on how chefs can be active change makers in this sense. Because of their significant contribution to generating food culture and because of their strong linkages to other agents in the food system, for example, with farmers, chefs and the restaurant sector in general are really crucial in supporting new ways to appreciate and value food or to get back to our roots and rediscover ingredients, approaches, and practices which move away from a commodification of food. We will start by reviewing the existing challenges and we will then proceed to discuss what kind of opportunities already exist or need to be created for chefs to not only start, but especially sustain change in their communities. In the third workshop, we will define a set of actions and recommendations which can guide this change. And for this, we will need the contribution of many different perspectives. Food and food culture are unique to different communities, and we want to make sure that these recommendations can be put into practice in a variety of settings while moving together towards the same direction. So I really welcome you to join the Healthy and Sustainable Diets session so we can join forces and work together for a healthier and more sustainable food system.
Thank you so much, Francesca. That was brilliant. 3 minutes dead on. So fantastic. I'm convinced. But I'm now going to pass over to Emanuela to talk about waste and why that's the session that you want to join.
Hello, I'm here, but I cannot open my video.
I'm sure that's okay. If you just
okay, if you can hear me, I can speak because yes. I can deliver my speech.
Brilliant.
So hello everybody. My name is Emanuela Bizzaro. I work for NIPNET, a vet provider, one of the partners that will be running the next food waste sessions. I would like to ask this speech with some questions. Do you know that the average restaurant meal is more than 4 times larger than it was in the 1950s? Do you know that restaurant dinners leave 17% of meals uneaten and the 55% of those leftovers are not taken home? This means that we eat more and today we waste more. This belongs to food loss and waste. I have the video. Okay, hello. So food waste refers to food appropriate for human consumption being discarded, whether or not after it is kept behind its expiry date or left to spoil along the entire food supply chain. So why does food waste affect everyone? Because food waste is the third largest greenhouse gas emitter after China and United States. When you throw away one orange, you are throwing away 1 kg of carbon dioxide. When you throw away an apple, remember you are flushing the toilet 7 times. So the amount of food lost or wasted translates into about 1/4 of all water used by agriculture. You have to imagine the food waste as a pyramid, as an iceberg. What we see at the top, the bill we pay at the producer and retail price. But what we don't see is the bill from nature, like eroded lands, cleared forests, loss of biodiversity, increased water scarcity, increase of food prices, and climate change damages. And last but not least, there is an economic loss because food wasted is money wasted. Every year, 1/3 of the food produced in the world is wasted. About 1.3 billion tons of food from the farm to the fork. In Europe, one third of the food produced in the world is wasted, about 1.3 billion tons. And each person wastes 173 kg of food annually. That would be enough to feed all the hungry people in the world two times over. That's why the role of chefs is crucial. Chefs are at the heart of the global food system. They can bridge the gap between farm and fork, as they can help to reframe food system challenges. For instance, by measuring food waste data every day with appropriate tools in restaurant kitchens, they could save an average of a significant percentage of food waste and food cost. So that's why, you know, it's important that only what we can be measured can be managed. And that's why the series of workshops run by NIPNET will be aimed to focus on the interconnection between the role of chefs and the reduction and prevention of food waste, considering three different perspectives: so challenges, opportunities, and ideas for actions. It's important to consider the menu as a communication and marketing tool, putting in it the sustainable practices in your business, such as rethinking your menus to avoid food waste, donating the surplus of food, communicating to your customers on how to avoid leftovers, emphasizing the importance of portion sizes, building good relationships with suppliers, and sharing values. And what about the impact, including the food waste prevention as a transversal competence in catering curricula for vet centers for the chefs to be? So there is a lot at stake, as you can see. And that's why we strongly invite you to join us in the sessions dedicated to food waste on December, February, and April. And remember, love food, reduce waste. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Emanuela. That was brilliant. And I've got to agree with David Swan's comment that food wasted is money wasted. It's a great line. It's fantastic. I think that should be front and center of everyone's mind, if nothing else, particularly in these times. Thank you. And now I'm going to pass over to Karen to explain to us why technology tools for chefs, that's the thing that we should all be signing up to. So over to you, Karen.
Thanks a million, Duncan. Hi, everyone. I'm Karen from Nutrix, and I'll give you a quick 3-minute overview of what we're going to be discussing in our technology tools for chefs workshop. So we know that catering teams face multiple challenges every day: staff shortages, supply chain disruption, inflation, and the cost of living crisis means that time and resources are limited. This means taking on additional responsibilities such as carbon tracking or sustainable menu design may seem impossible. But the good news is advances in technology now means we can do more with less. Technology is now easy to use and offers multiple advantages for chefs. For those of you who don't know us yet, Nutrix develops software to help businesses unlock the hidden value of food data. And food data includes costs, allergens, and nutrition information. With this data, businesses can manage recipes, create labels, plan meals, create digital menus, and now measure environmental impact at the click of a button. Our goal at Nutrix is to bridge the gap between the knowing and the doing. When it comes to the environmental impact of food, operators know they need to do something, but where do we start? Our mission is clear. Our technology helps operators to start and accelerate their journey to net zero without the hassle. And how do we do this? Our team of experts have built a robust and reliable environmental matching system using scientific peer-reviewed data to bridge that gap between science and industry, automating the best possible carbon and water data points to 1.4 million foods. This technology automates tracking and reporting of environmental impact tailored specifically for the hospitality and food service sectors. And what does it deliver? A simple and easy to use system that's been tried and tested by chefs. Compliance with legal obligations, such as allergen declaration. Optimization of business operations through supply chain transparency and cost management. and now within the same system, data insights to support strategic climate action. Technology removes the burden on chefs and simplifies the process when creating and reformulating healthy, sustainable menus. So please join us to gain a better understanding of how our technology tools for chefs can help you to streamline food data management and develop an evidence base for strategic climate action. Thanks so much, and we hope to see you at the workshop.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Karen. Yes, and again, I'd be excited to learn more about technology here. It's so important in this day and age, and this could be a great way to deliver sustainable food systems. So I would just like to remind everyone that now you've had the pitches, we're going to go into a Q&A with some really, really exciting speakers and participants in this Q&A. Before we do that, could you please type your questions if you've got them into the chat box, because we'd like to take the opportunity to ask these speakers their views on this project and other related things. And I'm excited to note that we've got participants in this workshop. We've got people from Namibia, from China, from Sweden, from Ireland, from all across Europe and all over the world and the south of France. So it's really exciting to see such a broad range of people involved in this. But I'm going to pass over to Will to introduce the next session for you and the panelists. Will.
Thanks, Duncan. Hi, everyone. I'm conscious of time, so I'm going to whistle along with the panel session. If the panelists are able to turn on their videos, that would be great, so we can see your lovely faces while you're chatting. Thanks ever so much. So just to introduce everyone, we are joined by Paul Newnham. Paul is the director of SDG2 Advocacy Hub and is the founder of the Chef's Manifesto that Sophie talked about earlier in the session. We're also really lucky to have Paul on the advisory board for the Climate Smart Chefs project. So welcome, Paul. We also have Julia Riedo. Julia is the Agricultural and Food Sustainability Policy Officer at WWF in the European office. Welcome, Julia. And also Susan Meal. Susan is the Regional Sustainability Director for Europe and the Middle East for Compass Group. Compass Group, I'm sure you know, are one of the biggest catering and food service delivery companies in the world. So it's a real pleasure to have you all join us today. So I just want to kick off actually with some reflections from all of you. We're interested in the challenges and opportunities for chefs and how policy can help move that forward, I guess. So for just what are the reflections in terms of opportunities and challenges? And if I can start with Paul, you've obviously been doing work with chefs all over the world. So where do you see these opportunities and challenges?
Yeah, thanks, Will. And it's so great to be with you today and just to hear about this project and the way the project is just coming to life, I guess, with this training program and everything. Look, and it's great to see so many chefs from around the world, so many friends, as well as chefs just really making an impact on the ground. So I think, you know, the challenges are really clear. We all know more than many about the challenge of COVID. It was a huge challenge. It prevented restaurants from opening. It made many businesses have to pivot their model very significantly. This accelerated certain change in certain areas, but it also created lots of challenge in terms of operation and staffing and other things. There's a lot of COVID protocols. There's a shift from indoor dining to food deliveries, and there's also been a major mental health impact for chefs and livelihoods were at risk. And so there's lots of challenges being a chef and talking to many chefs across Europe and around the world, trying to find talent and to find staff even, it can at times be very challenging. But there's been many chefs that have also responded to this challenge in really creating the tensions between sustainability and keeping businesses afloat, thinking about how to really meet frontline needs of workers, but then also to try and make the business work. And so, you know, we've seen this challenge kind of be responded to in many different ways and seen many practices kind of coming through. And seeing transformation in that kind of space. I know Connor Spacey, who's on here, he runs a food space in Ireland, and there's lots of examples in the work that he's done around food waste. And during COVID, they pivoted the business to really support some of the frontline workers to really develop in different ways? And then how do you create a zero waste, the sourcing through a food service kind of setup? And that's always very challenging. I think, you know, there's also been a lot of focus around food. So when people were forced to stay home, there was a lot of people getting back into the kitchen and thinking about food and provenance and the impact of food they eat. And I think, you know, this has been very interesting just to see how that then translates to restaurants and what that looks like in that kind of translation back. The food crisis at the moment that we're facing in many parts of the world has really put an impact on the cost of food and ingredients. And I think this has also really driven a big challenge in restaurants because people are having to think about ingredients and then make choices. And that's actually meant in some places to choose to go to lesser ingredients to keep costs down or to put prices up and then risk not having as much profit or having as many people in. And so this is a very real conversation at the moment around how we work. But I think it also creates opportunities around seasonality. It creates opportunities around diversity. So as certain products have gone up in price, the transition to more biodiverse products and other things has been really helpful. And so I think, you know, as we've seen that around the world, there has been a real shift where we've seen chefs starting to think differently to bring in much more newer ingredients, different ingredients that maybe were forgotten in some parts of the world are coming back onto menus because they're being discovered locally, they're being discovered as being highly nutrient dense. And so there's been this kind of transition that started to happen on menus, and you've seen that in many different examples around the world.
Thanks, Paul. That's super helpful, and you really grounded us in what's happening today. You know, we're coming out of one pandemic, but we've also got a cost of living crisis and various other challenges. So, I guess that's the tension, isn't it, between what we want to do for the future and what we need to do right now today, in order to keep operating as a business. Susan, you guys live this every single day. How does this play out for yourselves at Compass Group?
Thanks, Will. Well, great to be here today as well. Great conversation so far. Firstly, we're optimistic. So we think of every challenge as an opportunity to start with. And looking at this from Compass Group's perspective, we've had some really good and ambitious climate commitments in place for a year now. And we were really proud to be the first international company in the contract catering industry to announce those commitments, but to actually turn them into tangible positive action is another thing. And the people we really, really depend on are our chefs and kitchen staff. And Sophie already referred to this, but our chefs absolutely must carry on making delicious meals and creating amazing experiences, which is what they love and are very good at. But they also, of course, need to be more climate friendly. And the chefs also need to help us promote that move to more healthy and sustainable diets. If our chefs don't believe in it, nobody will. So Compass has over 500,000 employees globally. And obviously many of those people are chefs and their teams. And just to put that into perspective, we serve 5.5 billion with a B meals a year. And we like to think of every meal as an opportunity. So it doesn't take much to work out that means we've got 5.5 billion opportunities to drive change a year. So it's a massive opportunity for us and for our chefs. Now, almost 3/4 of our emissions relate to the food we buy. So the key focus points for our chefs are using better products. And by better, I mean their local produce from more sustainable farming or production methods, or products that have a positive social impact. And just reformulating our menus can really bring down both the emissions and the food waste and be better for the communities around us. Now, one of the big challenges I have in my role is rolling out training programs to every single unit we have in multiple languages. And if we want to educate our chefs properly, we need that. We're getting there, but over the past couple of years, it's really been a case of making do with what was available in the different countries, which, to be honest, wasn't too much. And another big challenge is on the digital and IT side. Obviously, people like nutritics there can help quite a lot. Firstly, getting producers and suppliers to understand the emissions and nutritional values of their products, then validating them, because they're not always what they say they are. And then finding the right systems, obviously, to label our meals as well. And labeling meals that change every day and vary from site to site is, again, no easy feat. But that certainly helps us nudge consumer behavior towards the better and more sustainable diets. And also linked to labeling, another challenge we have is that the nutritional content of meals provided is very much tailored to specific consumer needs. So that particularly in schools and hospitals, for instance, where we have consumers with really different dietary requirements, and some of them can be actually, you know, quite critical. We still need to follow those requirements, and all we can do is apply a climate-friendly filter to them and ensure that, you know, they maintain that nutritional value. So we can, for example, incorporate lower emission products with more climate-friendly packaging, but we can't apply standard labeling information, you know, which is more common in packaged foods in other parts of the food industry. Then just to finish, if I may, if we buy local or organic products, for example, it's often hard to get the volumes we need when we're producing millions of meals every day. And that obviously the checks that need to be done in terms of food safety, origin, packaging, etc., are really numerous. So it's often us that have to actually guide the farmers or producers to get, you know, the right certifications and documentation in place. So, I mean, I could go on forever about this, but, you know, I think those really are some of the key opportunities and challenges for our chefs.
Thank you, Susan. That was such a comprehensive list of, like you say, opportunities and challenges. I'm hearing all sorts of things around training, education, labelling, standards, data, price points and everything bundled into one. And I'm going to resist the temptation to try and solve this entire piece of work in 30 seconds. I really want to hear, Julia, your reflections on this. You work with policy. So how do we bridge this gap between the challenges, the opportunities, and what's happening at a policy level?
So thanks, William, and to the others as well. It has been a very insightful conversation for now. So everyone has to play a role in the transition for more sustainable food systems. And I think policymakers have a big one. So I have been thinking how they can support the role of chefs in shifting and consumption and have a more sustainable food system. So for example, thanks for Paul for mentioning the role of price of food prices. One of the aim that can have policymakers is to make sustainable food the most affordable and accessible choice, for example. Because for now, most of the time, more sustainable food is considered also the most expensive one and is marketed as one for higher income families, for example. And one of the policy tools that member states can use is, for example, to reduce VAT taxes on fruit and vegetables. And also, for example, governments can refrain from funding promotion of unsustainable food and advertising unsustainable food. The other element that policymakers can use is, for example, sustainable dietary guidelines that for now are not very used at the member state level, but is a tool that it already exists. And dietary guidelines can be used as a reference point for example, for restaurants, for chefs, for caterers. And so also governments can set a series of incentives to help restaurants and food services provider to use more these dietary guidelines that can also be customized according to the cultural aspects of each country, for example. And policymakers also can have a role in regulating, for example, retailers and push them to have a better sourcing of products. It means push them to source more food from agroecological production, small farmers, and the short supply chain, for example. And I mentioned in this kind, this series of policy tools that are in the hands of policymakers, because actually, especially at the EU level, for now, the EU institutions have almost unique occasion to implement this policy. That is the Sustainable Food System Law that is currently under discussion at the level of the European Commission. So under this proposal, the Commission is preparing, for example, a proposal to help a public procurement to be more sustainable, and to have a series of criteria to increase the criteria of sustainability of public procurement, for example. So I think that this is a really unique occasion for the European Commission to undertake the transition towards more sustainable food systems and to complete the farm to fork strategy, because it has been announced already in the farm to fork strategy. And yeah, I think the Commission really should take this opportunity and set some ambitious proposals. I think this is there's a lot that can be done, and this is one of the biggest opportunity that the Commission has.
Thanks, Julia. That's super, super interesting. I know nothing about policy, so I feel like I've learned a ton of stuff in the last few minutes alone. We've got a few minutes, I think, before we go into Q&A. So I guess what I'd be quite interested to hear from all of the panelists is, we can't write a paper in this project that's got 150 or 200 recommendations for EU policy. We've got to aim for the real material policy recommendations that are really going to change things. So I apologize for putting you on the spot ever so slightly, but if you could choose one or two things that would really help alleviate the challenges that you've mentioned or build on the opportunities. And, you know, it could be like data consensus, it could be fiscal incentives. All of these things are potentially on the table, I think. It would just maybe help stimulate some of the thoughts for everyone else as we move through the process of these roundtables. So does anyone want to jump in with a couple of key policy? Paul, your thumbs up, I'll go to you.
Okay, yeah, just I think, William, there's a couple of different things to keep in track. So last year there was a UN Food Systems Summit in September 2021, and there was over 100 countries that set out national pathways to achieve food system transformation. And I just think if you're looking at those pathways and actually implementing them, the EU could really help countries in Europe to do that. And also beyond, to deliver them with expertise and knowledge and help, you know, really take them down to the ground level, and so work with chefs and other food system actors to bring them into reality. I think one of the things that often also in policymaking that sometimes gets missed is that people eat food and that it's built on taste and tradition and culture and location. And I think chefs need to be brought into that conversation really to help guide the policy formulation and to help to think about the way that it's brought forward. Because we often talk about nutrition in a very health sort of space. We talk about agriculture in a kind of about almost commodities separated from flavor and delicious meals. And so I think there's something there around how that's put on a plate, what the conversation looks like, how it tastes, how it connects to location, culture, and space. And I think that kind of behavior change also needs to be brought in when you're thinking about policy creation at the EU level.
Thanks, Paul. Yeah, so there's sort of a top-down, isn't there, helping the national pathways, but also getting chefs to help you with that in the first place. Probably seems sort of, I've probably mangled your summary a little bit there, but that's super helpful. Julia, Susan, jump in with any, and Susan, your hand's shot up, so I'll go to you next.
Yes, I mean, I think for me, help with the funding of green initiatives, whether that's, I mean, that's quite a broad comment, because it could be for training systems, more efficient equipment, or things like lower tax on climate-friendly products, or even higher tax on climate-unfriendly products. I think any of that would be really, really useful.
Thanks, Susan. Yeah, so looking at taxes. Julia, come on, you've got the last.
So, I had to choose one because it was difficult. So I think that speaking again about the role of the European Commission now, for example, about this law that is upcoming, I think what is really important is to have an ambitious law. And in order to have an ambitious law, the Commission should start thinking to set some targets, because if they are proposing a law that is supposed to set the legislative framework for the transition towards a sustainable food system, they need to have a precise target, because we could see also with the climate law, it's really one of the few things that can work and move member states to align about the indication from the Commission. So I think that's I think one of the few things that the European Commission can do to be sure that all the future policies and the existing one are going in the same direction. Yes.
Thanks, Julia. So it's kind of giving targets and some accountability to the national pathways that Paul was talking about, maybe, and that's maybe where it fits in together, and then funding it properly to help Susan and people like that to actually deliver it on the ground. I think we're kind of bang on time. I think I'm not too sure if my clock's a little slow or a little fast, but I'm calling it bang on time. I think we now have a short Q&A session. So panelists, if you can stay with us with your videos on, and Duncan, I think I'm handing back to you for the questions.
Yes, I've got a few questions coming up, some which I'll aim at you, Will, but some for everyone else. So one thing that I remember since my time working on food systems, I've been very fortunate. I've worked on several initiatives already. So I spent 2.5 years working with IKEA on IKEA food on food systems. And then I've also worked with Sodexo on their sustainable food system program. So I'm aware that there's a lot of programs and projects out there at the moment, but a couple of people have been asking these questions, and I think it's important. Anyone can answer this, is how can an initiative like this link to other ones that are working with chefs and the food service industry? Because what we don't want is to have like sort of lots of siloed projects going on side by side, but not talking to each other. So have you got any ideas of how we can ensure that we collaborate as we go forward? So I might start with Paul, because he's been leading the charge.
Yeah, look, it's a really good call, Good question, Duncan. I think part of the challenge is that there's so much to do. So what often happens is we kind of create lots of initiatives to try and do that. I think the key is to plug into frameworks which exist. And so the Sustainable Development Goals are a framework. The National Pathways are a framework. There's often things at the UN level or the EU level. And I think they can become organizing principles in which coalitions can be built of different initiatives to build into each other and to connect. So, I mean, obviously, you know, I'm very involved in the Chef's Manifesto, which works with chefs that are also involved in many other initiatives. And I think there can be a complementary approach because that lots of initiatives generally, they become very focused on particular issues. They might work on food waste, or they might work on, you know, social feeding, or they might work on biodiversity promotion. And I think it's how we bring that into umbrellas and look at integrating into systemic ways. So I think there's definitely, it's an and, not an or. It's like, you know, I think it needs to be how we build that up, and we find different ways to help people to be able to shift towards the way they work. But I do think there's a constant need to be sort of almost posturing towards one another rather than away from one another in what we're doing.
Thank you. Yes, I agree with that. And Julia, Susan, do you have any thoughts on that?
I mean, from my side, I just think that the more people who are involved in these topics and pushing them from different sides, the further we're going to get. We're all in it together. We've all got similar problems, really. So, you know, I just think we'll, the more the merrier.
I think it's very important to create a movement as well around the need to shift and towards more sustainable food system. So it's really something that involved all the actors and across the whole supply chain. So yeah, it's quite evident. Yeah.
Thank you. Yes, and Will, you've got your hand up.
Yeah, I was gonna say one practical thing. All of these initiatives can join these different workshops so that they can help us to get the framing right for the EU. So that's sorry, one thing they can do today is start joining these workshops with us.
Okay, and another question that, again, I've got that's come up is how can we engage with chefs across the board? So one's working in food service all the way up to one's working in Michelin-starred restaurants, because they've got very different tensions and pressures on them. But is it a different way of engaging them, or can we engage them through one system? Yeah. Susan, I'll ask you. You work for Compass.
Yeah, I mean, I think we can engage them all. I mean, again, I think they've got similar problems. Whatever kind of restaurant they're working in, a lot of the things they'll have in common. They'll all want systems. They'll all be having recruitment problems. The food costs will be high for all of them. They'll having to substitute products to make them more sustainable. And it's the similar products they'll be substituting, maybe making them look a little bit flashier than others. But I think, yes, we need to engage with them all if we can.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. Another, I think, for example, that it's even chef from food providers can have a really big role. Procurement, food service procurement is a big part of the demand, and so demand for healthy food. So if public procurement, for example, start to shift towards this direction, it can really change the way of consumption, and also the subsequently to influence the type of production that is needed. So, and of course, Michelin chef can have a role to advertise and to influence consumers on the way of eating, so eating better. If it's something that it comes for a Michelin star chef, I think can be more influential. They have a big visibility now.
Thank you. Yes, cool. Thank you. And Paul, I've got a question that's come up for you from Florence Segal, who she was working on sustainable diets way before any of us started on it. Is a leading figure in it, and the question is, Is there a need to have a coalition of chefs on sustainable diets, an alliance or a movement around this? And it's not what you're doing. Is it something that we need to create in the future?
Yeah, look, I mean, I would say there definitely is. Is it formalized? Maybe not. So what we've been talking a lot about is that the change can't just be to more climate-friendly food. It's got to be to climate and people-friendly food. So you've got to have health and climate, you know, addressed in the way that we address. We don't have time to deal with one issue at a time. We actually have to look at them all simultaneously. And so we definitely advocate that. So we talk about how do you create better healthy diets and sustainable diets. And so we've done that in a number of ways through the Good Food for All campaign, which was launched as part of the UN Food System Summit last year through the UN. We're looking at actually launching at the Climate COP, a campaign around promoting beans as a climate and healthy solution and trying to champion beans and legumes across diets. So there is different initiatives like this. And chefs, I think, can play a key role in doing that. How we organize to then maybe incentivize that to be added to diets. I know groups like Compass and others, we recently did an event with some of the Compass team around this, where they showcased lots of dietary transition that's being done. So, I mean, there's huge examples on this, Duncan, around the world. Is it in a coalition as such? Not formally as yet, but there's loose coalitions built around different moments that are driving it. But I do think it's thinking about climate and health, not ever just health or just climate. It's got to be both. And I think there's you know, thinking about people and planet in that sort of sense.
Thank you very much. Yes, I'm seeing my next project coming up. And now I'm just going to ask a couple of practical questions quickly to Will. So Will, as the project manager, so the toolkits and trainings from this project, will they be available and accessible for chefs and gastronomy business open only, or will they be open sourced and available for everyone? And does the initiative only cover the EU, or does it go beyond borders?
Thanks, Duncan. I get the really exciting questions here. So it'd be embarrassing if I get this wrong as well, wouldn't it? So the online training course is kicking off in January of next year, and we're running 8 editions of the course. So the applications for that are already open. So anyone can apply to join the course, but you do need to be a chef living and working in the EU because it's an EU-funded project. So that hopefully answers that question. We have a limited number of places where anyone can apply. But however, we will be putting a shorter version of the training course online at some point in the project. It's called a MOOC. I think that's a technical term for it. Don't ask me what MOOC stands for, but it's a short online training course that will cover the same topics. Everyone will be able to access that. And obviously that will be on the Climate Smart Chefs website. So anyone, whether you're in the EU or not, you will be able to go and access that content. So it's EU for the official training course, and then obviously the award scheme for the Climate Smart Chef of the year, as it were, after that. But then online access is as close to open source as you can get, basically. It'll be open for everyone through the website.
Brilliant. Thank you. Thank you so much. Well, that was really useful. I'm afraid we're out of time. I don't want to go too much over the time. So thank you, everyone, for joining us. Suzanne, Julia, Paul and Will, it's been brilliant to have this Q&A with you. So thank you so much. Thank you for joining us. I'm going to be a bit presumptive and say we're going to have the final session in June in 2023. So I'm going to try and invite you all to share your thoughts then as well, because it'd be fantastic to see what you think of what we've done over that time. So thank you very much. And I hope you're all going to be well and have great rest of the day. So just so everyone else who's been involved, please register at the link. We're going to send it to you. Please choose a parallel session, join the parallel sessions. I think they're going to be really, really exciting. They're going to be informative and a great opportunity to learn. So get in touch. The link will be sent to you directly after this session. So hopefully you'll get an email about it. And yes, so yeah, I look forward to seeing you on the 1st of December. There's only 20 places for each session, so places are limited. I will see some of you on the 1st of December, and thank you for joining us today. I found it very, very useful, very interesting, and I've learned a lot. And like I say, I have a new project to start developing. So thank you, be well, and we'll see you very soon. Goodbye.